Alright, welcome back YouTubers to some more Dominions 5 with the relay playthrough. We are in turn 46 and let's see what Asphodel has cooked up for us this turn. We have me casting some spells. Let's cover that first. I'm finding another fire gem here in the faraway sea, and then I don't think anything else. No, I don't know if I think this will be worth it in the long run, finding these magic gems. And we found a Weeping Stone in Latian down here, which is just one water gem, not a big thing. And now we get one water gem this turn, but Asphodel is probably going to take that territory, so maybe a bad call. Anyway, we're taking control of a few provinces where he doesn't leave PD behind, but then there are a few battles here, and we'll cover them. He is attacking onto my fort in the corner of my lake, and we only have a few. We are getting some pretty good pickups with my PD this turn here. Let's have a look at it. Look at the kill. He's taking some attrition on these stacks here. Alright. Not this one in particular. Alright, he lost what? 9 carrion beasts. So now it's down to 90 in here. Alright, then in Jotunheim. I was poking in Jotunheim to see what he had brought onto the good old Jotunheim capital, and he's not poured anything onto here yet, and that's fine, which means it's going to take him a longer time before he gets to claim it from me, which we are just trying to delay that in reality. So the fact that he chose not to move his army on, just fine. It's holding back in a province not far from here. Then in the Whirling Sea, I am taking this one with my little raiding group here, and there's not much left behind. In fact, they just kill the commander right away, which is really lucky and of course nice. So we summon one water elemental. This costs us one water gem taking this province here, but it's the big income province from my underwater provinces, so that's really nice to get that one back. Then in Dragon Point, this is this is the old Navarre province that he is now raiding. He didn't know that it's completely worthless. It's like 14 gold income or something like that. I don't really care about this one, but look at this here. They kill an elephant. Yeah, okay, so, they're not on the charge, but they kill a few things on the charge, and then this elephant here is bleeding. So this is the big carrion beast that he had, if any. Of them are big, and I think these bears are also relatively strong, but the elephants and the bears are the big ones in the groups here that are actually doing some of the hard work. I suppose they all do, but these are at least the better ones, if any of them, right? So, and this one dies to bleeding, which, in Mage Wars, I'm just going to point that out, that in Mage Wars, plants can't bleed, and neither can undead, but apparently in this game here, it's fine. Plants bleed, sap, whatever. So, Dragon Point. We killed two, but one of them was the elephant here. They're just classified as carrion beasts in here, which makes it really hard to see precisely what was killed. And then one Saturn mannequin. Then in Swamp of Solitude, I just put up a pit of PD here, but this is where his little raiding army with the Black Centaurs moved in. Not really anything in here. They don't lose anything. And in Deadlands, this is on top of my throne. He moves in his little thuggy guy, the Theosippos, the Carrion Lord. And this one, it was kind of interesting for me at least to watch. These guys here, they come in with 18 damage, 12 cutting on the little Lobo Guard. He takes a lot of hits, this guy, and in fact, if you look at the health bar down here, now it's hard to see, but now it's up to 4. He's down to 24 out of his 53. It got pretty close in this one. I'm gonna just point out that he's pretty lucky here. He's also, again, oh, this is blood surge, not bleeding, right? But, I mean, it's so close, and I think if this guy had gone in and hit him once with this Meteor Trident, then it would have been over, because he's down to 13 hit points here. Would have been so nice to kill this stupid thug here, but he manages to push through just barely, and then he kills the stack. It doesn't matter about the PD, but killing that guy would have made a massive benefit, so too bad. That was in Deadlands up here. And so his big army, we saw it in Rizia last turn, it's holding back here. And in fact, there's a few cool things to see here in the background. He's got the huge enchanted boar. and the Solar Ram and the Carrion Lord. But it's the Enchanted Boar and the Solar Ram are like unique summons that you can only one person can cast them, and then they generate gems. The Enchanted Boar generates earth gems, and the Solar Ram generates fire gems, and also 100 gold per turn. So he has made sure to grab these things. I always go for them in Dominions 5 enhanced games. They are specifically from the mod. And so he's really locked that down. I'm assuming that he then also is the one who has cast the, maybe not, the, I tried to summon another one of those unique summons over here, the Water Serpent, and I thought he might have done down here in the water, but he doesn't have a lab in here, so that can't be right. Then almost certainly it must be Yis, right? It could very well be Cetus, I suppose. He doesn't have a lab in here either, and I think you can only summon the Water Serpent underwater, so it must be Yis then. I didn't know that Yis had access to death gems, but he might, or death magic, but he might have that through his pretender or whatever. I don't know. But someone else has already cast it. And since these guys don't have labs here, it almost can't be then unless they lost the labs later down the line. Anyway, all good and well with that. We took this one here from him. We took this one here back. He doesn't leave behind. Again, this one here, he would have kept this one if he had put in one PD, because my guy here was set to retreat. So just one more time where he could have spent one gold to gain 78 gold. Which I always find a little bit interesting. Same story here. I took this one, and of course this one is only 7 coins, so it doesn't matter all that much. We've got another one of those though down here. The 27 gold here gained where he could have protected it with one gold. And I'm also got a... This is a forest province with a lab in it, which he will enjoy having this one, so I'm going to try to demolish the lab in here. In fact, I realized that we had demolished the lab in Jotunheim, because you can do that behind the walls. So there's no lab in Jotunheim, and that also means that I'm not getting these gems in here from Jotunheim. We are getting the gold, though, I think. But we can't gain the gems while it's under siege, because there's no lab in here anymore. So that's... Maybe I shouldn't have just demolished the lab without knowing that we could get rid of the fort as well. Something to consider for future playthroughs. It's fine. And we are not... I could move in. I'm assuming that he, at this point, he's building up here. He sat on this fort. He has gone out of his way to never do the predictable thing. The predictable thing would still be for him to move on to Jotunheim. That's what he told me he was going to do. So then, of course, he's still not going to do it, I think. Because I also held my army here. I think he's going to move his massive stack onto Deadlands and try to wrest that one from me. This is a throne that he will enjoy having. It produces nature gems, and I think that he can take... If he can take this one from me, he's definitely cutting me off from the southern area. And so I'm not moving in my army. I still want to see his army before I dedicate mine. So I'm moving my army up here to Mammoth Grove, where I think he might move in his Thug or this raiding stack in here. And the army here should not be able to move all the way to Mammoth Grove. So we should be safe here. We're also getting a few reinforcements down from Old Flood coming up into the Mammoth Grove. So we are boosting the armies with a little few extra, I think one extra Star Child and one extra of these slave mages are coming up here. And then up here in the corner, I'm sure Asphodel is laughing at me because I'm dedicating a lot of time to eradicating these two mini stacks that he has here. And he's got like oceans more of these stupid stacks of undead. But I'm having fun trying to figure out how to defeat them. At this point, we've cornered this one in the corner and cornered it in the corner. It can move to one of these two provinces, right? That's all it can do if it wants to keep staying in my territory. The other thing that he can do, of course, is to try to move out and attack either Nabar or Yis from here, but unless they are specifically allowing him to do it, that should incur some diplomatic tension. And if they are allowing him to do it, well, I can't. Then what can I do? I mean, then... I'm talking to some of these guys now, and it all seems like they want me to beat Asphodel, or at least do well against him. So I'm assuming that they are not going to now like help him. So that means that this stack should stay in my territory, and that leaves it with these three. So I'm posting armies in all three that can beat it. And this one up here is, we need to consider that one too, because likewise, it has three provinces. This one, these three either stay, which I don't think he's gonna do. This is a crappy province. He doesn't make money off of it. No reason for him to stay. He doesn't get the one fire gem. So I'm poking it with another guy here with a treat order just to see if he puts up any PD. Then I think he is gonna move. I think what's gonna happen is that he's gonna move these two armies together in Black Waters, hoping that I would vacate that province. So this is where we are leaving the strongest force. Then the other thing that he can do is to go south here and south here. And so in here, the strongest force in here, because if it, a combination of the two stacks, they need to be able to win against both. But in here we have the weakest stack, here. Very embarrassingly, remember in the previous episode how I said we were also defending in here? If he had moved in, he would have met no resistance, or very little, because all of my scripting for this province in particular was reliant on having two communion masters in here, and they were not set to move and patrol, they were just set to move. And so all my communion slaves were set to patrol, and it would have been just them and the PD. So good thing that he didn't come in here. I messed up the scripting or the movement orders. But now they're all patrolling, so that if he comes out here, we will punch them to death with our glorious troops here, I hope. I have also boosted the PD in here a little bit, same with here, since if we keep the provinces, we might as well keep the PD a little bit high. So we are investing that a bit. And then in here, we are leaving behind two groups of these things from the void, and a good amount of mages on the main thing about this whole thing here is that I am wasting a ton of research right now, and I'm sure he's loving it. So like he's costing me a ton of research with almost no investment at all. It's fine. Then and the same story here. We are moving in a lot of stuff, and I'm hoping not to lose my units. Obviously, I'm overkilling it, I think, which I would rather do than lose the fight. If that little undead stack wipes a stack of my star children with along with the things from the void and all the thing, that would be devastating, like, and embarrassing for me. So better to overkill it and make sure that we win instead of going low and hoping that he playing the odds. I don't know Asphodel well enough to combat them super efficiently. Here is probably on the Sea Untamed here. I don't think he's gonna stay, but if he does, this is actually our weakest force. I think we have the Isolmensals and a group of these otherness plus the Shoggoth Bots summoning two water elementals in here. And we have two communion masters with just astral. So not a big force here, but hopefully it'll be enough. Yeah, this guy should have been scripted in the same way as up here. Communion master, then empower magic beings. We need to cast this one more. This is a pretty good way to boost my many attacks guy with all the tentacles. Not so much against these guys, but for like these guys here, having four more strength means four more attack on three different attacks, right? So boosting them with four more strength is pretty good. I think it's halved, in fact, so it's not entirely true, but it's still boosting several attacks. Okay, and that's about it for this turn. We're forging a Skull Staff with the Pretender because I cannot random into a Starspawn with two death, apparently, and the same story with, we can't apparently random into a two earth, and I don't ever, I actually have a bit of money to spend this turn, and we have, I'm starting recruitment of these Meteorite Guard, because they have very low upkeep costs, we can actually keep them around, and they should be good for killing some Asphodelian troops, I hope. Not much else to say, we are casting more Horror Specs and Dark Knowledge, and that's about it. Yep. So a relatively efficient turn. And yeah, that's it for this episode, folks. So I hope you are all enjoying my struggles against Asphodel. We'll see how it unfolds in the next episode. One thing to note is that I've spoken to Arcosophal, and he says that he was not the one who dispelled my ghost armada, which wouldn't make sense in my mind either. He said he would in fact have preferred it stuck around, which I also thought would be the case. So at that point, I'm thinking it's probably Nabar, unless Asphodel has access to Astral somehow, which I don't know how he would do it, but he probably could do it somehow. Maybe with this solar... Well, if he's got access to the solar ram, I think there's some Astral in that one. It might be him. It probably is him then, because it was taking out his provinces. Look, he hasn't even reclaimed these three provinces that were last hit by the Armada. I think maybe these two guys are like using it as a border in between them. But it's kind of interesting that there's a throne here that no one's claiming. Not a big deal. All right, I just wanted to point that out. So yeah, that's it for this episode. See you guys in the next one, and that's it. Bye-bye.